Thank you, Renika and Cheryl. You were awesome. You rock. I'm not going to stand over at the podium because I'm too short. I'm delighted to be here to talk to you about the future of funding and to share a promising new model for collaboration to drive social progress. I'd like to start off by sharing three statistics in three different sectors. First, the public sector. Peter Orszag and John Bridgeland, both senior officials in both the Obama and Bush administration, wrote in their book Moneyball for Government that 1% of federal programs is backed by the most basic level of evidence that these programs have been shown to work. Remember that. Second statistic, this is in the social sector. Of the 200,000 or so nonprofits that were being created between 1975 and 2008, only 200, that is 0.1%, of these nonprofits have reached $50 million in annual revenues. We have all this nonprofit activity in this country. We actually have 1.5 million nonprofits. The vast majority of them are subscale. The third statistic, this one in the private sector, and particularly in the realm of investments. Bank of America U.S. Trust did a customer survey last year and found out that 60% of their clients really want to reflect their personal values in their investment portfolios. So 1%, 0.1%, and 60%. These three statistics, what do they have in common and why do they matter? I think each of them point to this dire necessity that we want to change the status quo, whether it's in government or social sector spending or our investment framework. And each of them expresses a blockage, or more positively, the corollary ambition that we want to actually make our community stronger. We want to alleviate suffering. We want to provide opportunity and actually move the needle on some of these gnarly social challenges that we face. Let's take the 1% again. It's not that Peter Orszag and John Bridgeland are saying that only 1% of federal programs work, but they're saying that only 1% has been measured and shown to work, and that we simply don't have the tools and the data to see what's working and what's not working. I mean, that is just amazing. Far too often now, policymakers are simply relying on the gut instinct, if you will, when investing scarce taxpayer resources. And we need more evidence-based policymaking to have better efficiency and better effectiveness in our public spending. The second statistic, the 0.01%. The problems we face are massive, yet the organizations tackling them are small for the most part. And nonprofits are increasingly expected to track their data and report on their outcomes as opposed to inputs. What we're hoping to do is have a world where the best nonprofits, the most successful programs, have a pathway to access the kind of growth capital that we see in the private sector so that these organizations can serve many more people and have meaningful and transformative change. Finally, the 60%. These are what we call impact investors. More and more people really want to reflect their personal values in their investment portfolios, or what my co-founder, Sir Ronald Cohen, calls the invisible hearts of markets. I think impact investing is really shaking up this old worldview, this bifurcated worldview organized with this bright line with, you know, for-profit activities on one hand, maximizing financial returns, and then on the other hand, just charity, giving away your money without expecting any back. And I think that worldview is being changed. So these three movements, government accountability, nonprofit transformative scale, and impact investing, the confluence of these three movements have really paved the way for a new approach, one that's building on the great work that many of you are doing, bold, creative thinking that many sectors have been pioneering, one that brings together a new way to forge the public, private, and social sectors to work together to tackle social challenges. And that's called Pay for Success, and this is what our team at Social Finance is charged with building in the United States. So what is Pay for Success? It is essentially a tool, and it starts with government asking a question. what policy priority am I aiming to solve, whether it's improving early childhood or upskilling our workforce or cutting recidivism. Then an intermediary of sorts, like social finance, would come in and then raise private capital to fund nonprofits to deliver services, nonprofits with a track record of success and an evidence base that their programs work. At the same time, we enter into a performance-based agreement with government that basically obligates the government to repay these investors their principal plus a rate of return if the metrics, and these are predetermined metrics, are achieved. And if the programs don't hit the marks, then government doesn't pay. So in other words, government only pays for success and investors only benefit if society does. So this is all very abstract, so I'm gonna share a specific example. In 2013, we partnered with the state of New York in a pay for success agreement with the twin goals of increasing employment and improving public safety. We then raised, with the help of Bank of America, $13.5 million to fund a great nonprofit called the Center for Employment Opportunities to deliver a comprehensive jobs program to 2,000 men leaving the New York State prison system. Without this program, over 60% of these men would recidivate back into the system. And this is the contract. If this program reduces recidivism and increases employment vis-a-vis a control group, then New York State would repay our investors their principal plus a rate of return out of correction savings when recidivism is lowered, as well as other economic benefits when folks hold down jobs and stay out of law enforcement, the court, and the ER. And throughout, an arm's length independent evaluator would keep track of the program and analyze the outcomes of these program participants vis-a-vis a control group in a randomized control trial, the highest level of rigor to determine the program's impact. And what if the program doesn't get the intended impact? Then government owes nothing. And again, government only pays for results. And this idea of risk transfer is actually really meaningful to governments. So pay for success is essentially then about ensuring that our taxpayers, those dollars that we put in as taxpayers, has value. Not only because government is only paying for programs that work, but these types of arrangements really encourage an investment in prevention. Whether it's, you know, cutting recidivism or investing in early childhood, we look for programs where you can invest a dollar of prevention today to save many more dollars of dealing with the problem later. Or the saying that, why would you put an ambulance at the bottom of the cliff when you can put a fence up high? It sounds really easy, but I think too often it's really difficult for governments to invest early in upstream, even though we know that an ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure. Obviously, vaccines are much cheaper than treating disease, and job training costs less than incarceration. And these are only, of course, the monetary benefit. We can't even begin to think about the value to the individual, the intangible value to the individual of a life better lived. And here's another staggering statistic. In the current fiscal environment, and based on the current caps on annual appropriations, federal investments of any kind, infrastructure, R&D, and especially in education and training, as a percentage of GDP, will be the lowest in the last 50 years. I mean, that is an extraordinary statistic. We simply have to do a lot more with far less. So, this is a new idea, and it's an idea 6 years into the making. Our sister organization, Social Finance UK, launched the world's first social impact bond in 2010, and where are we 6 years into this experiment? There are now 55 projects globally, and just looking at the pipeline in the United States, there are 10 launched projects in the United States channeling over $100 million of private capital into social change, and just our pipeline at Social Finance, we're developing projects to reduce prisoner recidivism, combating opioid dependence, keeping kids and their families together to avoid out-of-home placements, providing vocational skills, expanding high-quality pre-K, improving maternal and infant health, reducing childhood asthma, supporting the mental health and employment needs of our veterans, and I can keep going on. But when I take a step back and I think about what we and others in the field have learned over the last several years, it's a long list, and we continue to be learning a lot, and the challenges are huge, and the challenges are humbling. How do we standardize the process so this work becomes easier without losing the nuance and without crowding out much-needed prevention? How do we make sure that the introduction of even a modest financial benefit remains a force for good and not a path to unintended consequences? And if these early projects prove their value, how do we build a broad, sustainable financial market for human outcomes, just like the one that we have for building roads and bridges? How do we import that mainstream approach for our physical infrastructure to invest in human potential and our social infrastructure? So these are the questions that we wrestle every day as a team, but we feel so much conviction, as much as ever, about the promise of this tool. And it's one of these few things in today's American political economy that is, one, bipartisan, and two, a win-win for everyone. Government wins because they transfer risk and only pay for results. Nonprofits win because they can get to have long-term reliable growth capital to do their great work. Investors win because they get to reflect their values in their portfolios and derive financial return out of human life improvement. And of course, the biggest winner is society. And let's not lose sight of what Pay for Success is all about. It's not just a neat financing mechanism, and it's not an innovative public-private partnership. It's really is about improving lives, a means to an end, and the end is redirecting resources so that we can serve our society's most vulnerable. Thank you.